I usually don't pay attention to the crowd when I play. Like, of course, I notice them a little bit, but like, it doesn't affect me at all. But I like the way that they show up for the game.
I think when the crowd is cheering for you, it really motivates you to play well. But on the other hand, when they're cheering for the enemy team, you're like, I'm going to show them who they should be cheering for.
Well, Cyanide, if there's ever a time you need to show them who they're cheering for, it is now, because Fnatic, they are trailing behind Alliance 2-0 right now. It has been a dominant performance in Game 2. Alliance, they don't look like slowing down.
No, not at all. I mean, it's not even like the game is so close in the end. It's actually Alliance winning like 15,000 gold now twice in a row. Early game, it looks okay for Fnatic, but then we get the real big team fights, and Alliance just seem to be the better team at the moment here, unless Fnatic can change some stuff up. Because Champ Select has gone in favor of Alliance twice now. They need to do something different here. They keep banning Twitch two games in a row now. I feel like just leave it open, let it go to Taps, invest the ban into something else.
Well, Tabs might not even go that direction either.
Exactly.
That's the funny thing with Alliance now moving over onto the blue side. You can ban Twitch and he'll just first pick Cogmore anyway. So let's see if those switches happen. Nidalee, Syndra, same bans for Alliance. Ahri, Lee Sin banned against Shulk. I think it's worth it. Shulk's made some big plays with Lee Sin.
He's been absolutely fantastic, actually. He's the guy early game who makes all the plays, and also team bats, he's been the main engage. He's actually not been Wicked on Alistar Maokai. It's been Shulk and Lee Sin setting it up every time he had the chance. And Alliance don't want to toy around with any Kassadin baits here.
Yeah, Kassadin taken away. All of the focus on the mid lane from Alliance once again. Fnatic, what will they go with? Will they let Maokai through? It's kind of been a null point, honestly, if you were to ask me about it.
Yeah.
If we were to look last week at the quarterfinals, we think Maokai is going to be such a big deal. But these teams have already figured out how to counter it. Nidalee is open. I tell you, it's been banned again. I can't see that corner of the screen. It just throws me every time. Twisted Fate is banned out. And again, Cogmore straight away locked in by Alliance. Tabs is happy again.
So pretty much the same bans as game one, except now Kassadin was banned by Alliance instead of Orianna, and we had Lee Sin banned on the side of Fnatic instead of the Twitch. But it just leaves once again. You get possibly the best AD carry at the moment as your first pick. Yes, okay, Fnatic can reply with Tristana. Game one, they replied with Vayne. It didn't work out. They have to take something like Tristana here, unless they want to risk Alliance once again running double AD. It probably won't now that Kassadin isn't in the game. At least Nami should go on the side of Fnatic.
And a safe first pick on the mid laner here as well in their first rounds. Don't think it's a bad idea, in all honesty, with so much focus on those mid laners to take the safer option early on. We know that both Frog and Peke can really come up with the goods. Funny thing is, you first pick in that Nami, and we could just see Nip say, well, you know how effective my Unbreakable was last game when you were trying to start fights with your Tidal Wave. We're just going to go for a similar thing here again. Will we see a Talon coming for Froggen, though, in this mid lane?
It is actually a good pick against Orianna in there, because you silence her, so you won't be able to respond back with any damage or shield, and then you can get a lot of damage off onto her, but I haven't seen Froggen play Talon in a long, long time. Curb is normally the player in Europe who would pick Talon. He's not actually been winning games on it, though. But picking it as a counter, not be winning games.
It's a risky pick, isn't it?
It is. It's high risk, high reward.
High risk pick. Honestly, Alliance could play, take a risk now, but it's a dangerous game. You don't want to give the momentum back to Fnatic. So, Shulk, he's got a fallback as always. Kha'Zix getting locked in. Was a big, big part in the semi-final matches. Maokai, of course, once again for Wicked. And now we see Lulu and... Oh, Rek'Sai gets on Tristana.
Okay.
So, bit of a slow turnaround from Fnatic. They're going to take a while to get going here.
Yeah, again, they protect the AD carry come a bit like they ran in game one. They're going to try and do the same here now with Orianna, Lulu, and Nami, all to just peel for Rek'Sai in the late game. But they have to get to the late game, as you just pointed out here. I mean, Lulu is fine in the mid game, but it's all about your AD carry now, because he's the guy you want to protect. And of course, Tristana, strong early, weak mid game, good late game. So in that case, Fnatic will be looking to go late, and then it's just all about these teamfights and all about, once again, investing all your time and farm onto Rek'Sai and pray that he can carry. But Maokai can get a lot of armor, get in his face. Tristana is not able to jump away from a Maokai, and if you do lock in the Braum as well, you once again have the counter now for Nami in these teamfights with the Tidal Wave.
Oh, Zilean looking like it's going to be locked in. Froggen. Gonna be picking that one up, so they take the Braum and Zilean will fall in the hands of Froggen this time around. See how he does this one as he just readjusts himself and he sees like, okay, I'm playing yep. Zillion now, time to get comfy.
And in pretty much every game we have seen, Fnatic play, at least today, they've had a very hard time diving the back line of Alliance. This game is going to be the exact same. I mean, your top laner is Lolo. She's not going to run to the enemy backline. She's going to stay with AD carry. Same goes for Orianna. Same goes for Naimo. So you now have four people making the backline. You have no tank. Sana has to log in a tank. If he goes Elise, again, there's nobody to go into the backline of Alliance. And if they ever do catch Taps out of position, Zillion is there with his ulti to help him and make sure he stays safe. So on the side of Fnatic here, they're basically waiting for Alliance to engage the fight, and then it's all about just kite, keep dealing damage, and then when someone drops low, you go all in, you get the kill, you get the reset for Tristana, and then Reckless suddenly can start jumping in. But they have to kill the front line of Shook and Wicked, and then they also, of Nif and Wicked. We have already seen how tanky a problem can be as a support. Then you have now the poke coming in from Shook, who's most likely going to max his evolve his W. Same goes for Zillion, same goes for Taps as well with the long range poke. And nobody can dive him in the back line. Like, he's going to stay so safe here and just deal all the damage. There's no tank on the side of Fnatic.
Well, no team has ever pushed Fnatic this far in Europe. Gambit in spring 2013, they took them all the way in a best of five series. They were the closest, but right now, two games down, Fnatic are going to have to dig really deep in this match. Soaz on Lulu, it's a champion he's said so many times is the best top laner. Of course, that was a long time ago. That was back at All-Stars. Not too sure it's the same now. So will Alliance sweep their way through Fnatic and stage an absolute upset here? Because Fnatic, they are the kings of Europe. They are the reigning champions. Can they be dethroned? Hashtag Alliance win or hashtag Fnatic win to at LOE Esports. I'm not sure, honestly. Fnatic, while they've performed well, Fnatic, Alliance on the other side, have been impeccable. They've not been rocked. They've been confident and they've led the whole way through.
And they've said, coming into this one, if you watch those videos, they look super confident, despite the fact that there were a few shaky moments throughout the playoffs for them. They, you know, came into this one looking really well at 3-1. Fnatic themselves really struggled against Rocket. That one went down to five games. You could have argued that they could well have lost that final and been in yesterday's third place game. The problem that they have now is a massive comeback. Three games in a row is what they need.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game number three underway. Will it be the final one? That is the question. Massive Fnatic support live in-house here at Gamescom Hall 8. And you guys at home, how are you going to vote? Because Alliance, they've led throughout the summer split. They've 3-1'd every single team. They're currently 2-0 up in this best of five. And will they just close it out?
Well, Fnatic here, they have to go standard lanes because they have some very, very strong laners here. Lulu in the top lane is very strong in one-on-one. Orianna in the mid lane, of course, with Naomi just down in the bottom lane. Fnatic, they need standard lanes and need to win the lanes here. It's not even like that. My game is a lot better if you look on the side of Alliance here, because you have Zillion being logged in. Taps is going to get Trinity Force and be fairly strong in the mid game. He's actually going to be strong throughout the entire game. Maokai, get a rotation of one tank item, and all of a sudden you are actually very, very tanky, and also can be a big part of the mid to early late game here. So it's not even like Fnatic has stages, except for maybe the laning phase, where they should be able to win against the comp from Alliance here. Because late game, again, we just talked about how there's nobody to dive Taps. He's going to stay safe in the back line. There's so much protection for him here. And then it's just all about constantly hitting Fnatic down. Get one member low, and then you can also take them down here. There's, of course, no reset like on the side of Fnatic. And they just have to kite. I mean, they don't have any engage.
This will be a time for Fnatic to really not just step things up, but maybe something, go for something a little bit more unorthodox, something that Alliance aren't going to be ready for. You could also argue that they might also be thinking at this point, this is where we play standard, because you never quite know if those risky moves are going to play off. They're going to face check in here. There's the first Q coming down.
One more stun.
Zero to Yellow Star, but there's no big follow-up. Reckless is doing enough damage there to Nip to force Alliance to back off.
So if you do get standard lanes, like Fnatic wanted, if you're picking strong laners all around, been listening to our analysts down at the desk saying after game one, I want to see standard lanes from Fnatic, I want to see strong laners, and then see what they can do against the land here. So we simply have to see if they can win the lanes.
Oh, Rekkles now getting focused on. Taps wasn't quite on the same page when the stun came out on Yellow Star, and Nif was like, come on! I've got him stunned, what are you waiting for? Didn't manage to get the return. So, the poke this time should, at the start in that bottom lane, go the advantage of Fnatic, despite the fact, obviously, Rekkles is on Tristana, that Naomi will help. It's the big number one support currently that everybody favors. Mid lane, of course, Froggen and Peke. They're going to go at it. Level 2 first hit by Fnatic, and Rekkles leaps in. This is the aggression we may not have seen, but he's going to get stunned out. Nifmo will get focused. Tabs taken very, very low. The Ignite was used. It was countered by Tabs' heal, and he is safe for now.
And that was a very, very nice all-in by Fnatic's bottom line here, and a terrible situation for Alliance, because the wave was already pushing up towards, at least at the moment, once Fnatic hit level 2, it was up towards their own tower, so they had to stay very far up in the lane, and therefore had to use heal as well from Taps to actually stay alive. Nobody's top lane here. Shook looking for the first gank.
Oh, Twisted Advance comes down. Shook gonna get in there. Soaz may not even bother to flash this one. He's going down, and it's Shook that gets the first kill in there. And despite that great work down in the bottom, they lose on the first kill. Are they gonna be able to pick anything up? Tabs and Nif are at half HP. They've got decent CC. If they can only land it here under the tower, I still feel it could be a little bit too dangerous for them though. There is actually the teleport coming in. Wicked's gonna join in on this one, and that will force them off. I don't think there's any kill potential for Alliance, but it stops the dive.
And had a ward to actually spot Cyanide. Moving into the new, he was waiting. We could use the teleport. Has to now go actually back to base and then run all the way up to top lane. But Sugar's instant there. Might even fancy a fight against Soaz.
We'll see whether he does. I think he just wants to hold and soak up the experience, make sure it doesn't crash against the tower while Wicked's coming back. I'm pretty sure he's not going to go for any of those last hits. Peke taking low in the mid lane. Froggen getting the bombs down. And the rewind. Didn't go for the ignite, didn't go for that killer blow. Peke himself turned a bit of damage around himself, but this is a very testing time for Peke. This is the time to shine. He needs to go big, and he's against arguably the best player in Europe in the mid lane.
And that's one of the things about Froggen, that he doesn't mind wasting a ton of mana right at the start of the game to try and get some control on the lane. We see it. I mean, I don't think Peke even expected it. He actually shielded himself very late, so I don't think he expected Frog to just go bomb, rewind, bomb, slow, all at the same time there. And again, Froggen just going into this
Cyanide
one.
Is here.
We do see Cyanide moving around the back, though.
Oh, quick flash, gets rid of the cocoon. Froggen plays it safe, but we'll see whether Cyanide decides to play a return visit. Don't forget, level 5, Shockwave is available in the next level. That flash being burnt could be vital if Peke manages to catch him.
But Sugar's already level 5 here, going towards Cyanide, feeling very, very confident. And he's going to get level 6 very, very soon, and should be able to join in case Fnatic decides to gank Froggen. He does have his ult, he can buy some time, and then Sugar can come in there into the mid lane. So very nice start by Sugar. He's been looking very good today, and Cyanide has not had the same impact we normally see from him. Definitely been in favor of Sugar in terms of the junglers.
Oh, and they're going to do it again. Here we go. The bomb is down. Ignite is down. Shook's coming in from the back. Oh, the fail pass from Peke. And that is the kill. A second one for Shook. And this is the lane and jungler matchup that I think has been most impressive in Europe this year. Shook and Froggen are so good together.
It's just the synergy you had from the start. I mean, remember, it was always supposed to be Shook and Froggen together on this super team. They had some different players in mind at first. It didn't work out. Had to find some new ones, like Taps came in, Nif came in. Probably not too unhappy with how the team ended out because it is insanely strong. But Shook was always there from the start. Froggen said, I want to play with Shook. He's the best jungler in Europe, in my opinion. And they've been playing together ever since, and they have just shown great synergy from the start.
It was the nucleus, the beginnings, back in October 2013. That's when this team was first imagined by the mid laner Froggen. You guys are home, still hanging true with Fnatic despite the rough start they've had. The Fnatic faithful still tweeting strongly, but it's Alliance that are opening up once again with a good lead and a good start in the opening lane phase.
And if you look at it as well, Shook spent time in lane, effective time in lane, 2-0 ahead in farm as well. Okay, he actually taxed a bit of that from the mid lane, but look at this. He's going to be coming once again in, this time towards that bottom lane. Reckless is going to get hit by two. Can they actually get on top of him? He's level six here. It looks like Yellowstar will actually be the target. Yellowstar has a flash, but Braum
get one more
on him. He may get stunned up. One more.
No!
Do it. Ignite ticking.
Oh, they got him.
He got it. Oh! Down though to the tower and Reckless. So it's a one for one in the end.
So Shook actually decided to evolve his E, even though he's maxing his W. And normally Kha'Zix's junglers in Europe, we see them max W and evolve it as well. But Kakao actually from KT Arrows in the OGN finals, he went the same route here. He maxes W still, you have more wave clear in the jungle. And then you evolve your E, you evolve your Q as the next one. So you're basically looking for this skirmish power, like one-on-one burst damage. And it's also going to work because notice how Alliance wants to play these fights here. Nobody's going to touch taps. He's just going to stay safe, get everyone lower. Then Shook goes in, and he will be able to get the resets and keep jumping around.
And with those wings evolved, expecting to pay more visits now that Froggen's hit level 6 to that mid lane. He's actually level 7 now, but that ultimate available means he can dive very deep once again. Pekate gets a bomb, gets the rewind, gets another bomb. And the defensive ball is just simply not enough. It's opening up a groove, and Shook is nearby and able to jump in there. Blue buff now coming up. That's going to be a key, and it's actually forced Yellowstar to come up, ward out some coverage to give them a little bit of support in their mid.
It is insane how fast Shook is actually farming in his own jungle. I said before, you max your W still for the jungle clear speed. He's ahead in farm. He's been ganking once in top lane, once in mid lane, once in bottom lane, and he's picked up kills in every single lane. Fnatic is still doing well farm-wise because they have the winning matchup in every single lane, but they have been slowed down by the fact that Shook has been playing so well.
I see item-wise there, Froggen already taking massive chunks out of Peke, and that's only with that double Doran drink and the chalice in there. Meanwhile, Cyanide at the bottom lane, but there's no one there. There's no one really for the taking. Alliance's bottom lane backed off, and what? With the recall of Fnatic in the mid lane, Froggen and Shook are going to move in. This is a massive damage onto the outer middle turret already.
That's a lot of damage burnt down. They may finish it off here. You can see it's just not going to quite take it down, but that's not going to be too safe for Peke to linger around. He's had to call in reinforcements. Cyanide makes his way across. So far, he is safe. Now, Soaz, he's dived on in the top lane. Wicked, he seems to be having a good time up here. We can see Morell Nomicon is being built by Soaz, so he's going to continue to keep those basic attacks burning down along with the Glitter Lance on Wicked, but it's only a matter of time, it seems, and Wicked unharassed, despite the fact he is down on CS.
Look who's in the bottom lane. Safe.
Oh, this is going to be dangerous. Yellowstar gets knocked up by the ultimate. Uh-oh. There is Shook on top of them. They are going to get the bubble down, but Tabs is able to pick up the kill. The assist goes over to Shook. Meanwhile, Soaz and Wicked here on the top side of the map, having a big fight once again. The ultimate out of Soaz was used. Cyanide now coming up, but I don't think Wicked's going to be baited into that one.
Well, they want to dive him under the tower here. Don't actually even care if Wicked's going to get baited or not. They just want to kill him. They know the dragon is already gone because Yellowstar died in this bottom lane, so at least try and get a kill off in his top side.
Well, he's got his ultimate, he's got flash. It's going to be a 2v1, but he's going to get taken down. Didn't really put him too much resistance there, despite that Twisted Advance coming down. So, dragon taken, bought time, mid lane. That's got to be pretty low right now. Shockwave pulled in, Froggen doesn't care. Takes down the mid lane turret, he's got himself his rest. There it is. Now we see Shook pouncing in. Doesn't manage to get on towards Peke. The ignite was used and Peke was taken very low. Yellowstar trying to return some damage onto Shook. Not going to be enough.
It's just for the revenge. Didn't actually end up working because Peke was solo. They might be able to push down this tower though. Got Froggen back in base. He has no ulti. Actually, he's going to cancel his recall and stay.
Yeah, Wicked already a TP'd up towards that top side. Going to keep him zoned as well as he possibly can there with the ball. Nif actually going in like a man and trying to get rid of those minions. And in the end, half of the health of that turret is gone. We actually saw Wicked just TP to the top lane after going down, so he wouldn't have been able to help out either way. He does, however, return with a blasting one on top of that catalyst, so his Rod of Ages will be done relatively soon. Soaz has finished off Morell and Nomicon. And for Froggen, the Athenes is done as well. And we saw the confidence of him once again there. Puts the ultimate on himself, stays around to finish the turret as Tabs caught out someone, but that is Elise and Nami. There's not a whole lot of damage there for Tabs as Reckless didn't come in. Here it's Shook once again. This time, though, they finally got a ward down in that tri-bush and we're back off.
good coverage and simply just a couple of wards in the key placements there for Alliance. Gave them all the information they required for Fnatic. They do manage to react. They counter. Four members of Alliance all moved in bulk down there. They're waiting still in the bush. They haven't backed away though. So Fnatic want to make a play, but I'm not sure it's going to work out for them. Cyanide still holding steady. Peke's had to go back and buy, and Fnatic, yeah, wisely will retreat from this situation. That middle turret's being pressured. Froggen is doing work in that mid lane right now. He's behind in CS, but with the help of Shook, he's been leaping in there. It's just put Pekka into so much pressure in the way, so it's just been cleared instantaneously.
And we just need Alliance to go back to base once. They can all pick up a lot of wards, and then instantly you're going to see the top side of the map around the entrance to the jungle of Fnatic just be warded. The mid lane is going to get warded by Froggen as well, and they're going to have full control and see where everyone from Fnatic is moving around. Source in the in this top lane, he keeps pushing down the wave. He will get some damage on the tower, will be able to take it as well, all alone. And it seems like Alliance don't really care for now. Wicked is just trying to pick up the farm he can. They know they're going to lose the tower. It's going to be all about the next dragon.
Tower is gone. 30 minutes and 10 into this one. We have a 1400 gold lead for Alliance. A team that in their semi-final game against SK, went to four matches, they were behind in all four. There's a leap away. Actually, we already saw the cocoon landing. And look at the difference there between the two junglers. We said it right at the start that Shook's the carry jungler. Cyanide more of the support. And those kind of scorelines really prove that theory.
Massive difference between them. I mean, also look at this game here. Okay, you do have one kill on Cyanide, but that's been it. Shook has been everywhere on the map, part of every single kill. Or every time he went to a lane, he would get a kill. And also just look, if you look at the items, of course on Kha'Zix, you want to get all these damage items like he loves to do. And he can do it while on the other side of the Cyanide, building sites on Elise very early on, so not getting any combat stats.
Blue buff fight is coming. Shook fancies this one. He's got flash available, smites up there. If they can take this away from Peke, it's just another thorn in his side. They get the vision. Smite used by Cyanide. It does mean Peke won't get it. And you can see he's already hurting for mana because every single time he needs to use that defensive pull to stop Froggen pulling bombs on his head.
Oh, Soas may be in trouble here on this top side. The wild growth comes in from Soas together. Knock up Wicked flashes. He'll twist it up after the one single minion there over the side, but doesn't matter for him. Soas is able to get that kill. But look at Shook on towards Peke. He's going to use the ultimate. Froggen will flash in.
He's
there's
dead,
a bomb
dead.
Down. The bomb will get the kill, and that will put Froggen at 1-0-1. Meanwhile, down the bottom, Nif trying his hardest to get in there, and Alliance just turn on the switch of aggression.
Back and forth action. This game is opening up, and it's Alliance that are coming out on top. Yellowstar caught out this time. Glacial Fissure being used from Nif. Tab's not sure if he fancies this one.
Flashes across.
Soas teleported in behind them. They're going to come around. Alliance, now Wicked will join the party. That's going to be Reckless getting himself one kill. Gets the reset. Tab's goes down. Soas picks up that kill. Finally, something starts to go Fnatic's way. They're going to push on down this bottom turret, but Froggen, he's coming to counter.
And that was a very, very aggressive play here coming from Nif first, where he lands the ulti, but Taps is on the other side of the wall. He had to flash to actually get in range of Fnatic. We're just going to see it again here. Nif engaged, but look at Taps. He can't actually hit more than once. Reckless shoots him away. They move away from the wall. He has to flash over to join in and instantly teleport behind from Source. Wicked joins in as well, but they've already lost the fight. Cyanide comes, pick up a kill for Reckless. Did you actually get double? No, Source picked up the last one here. If there was no dragon for him to take, at least they got a few kills.
Sometimes you have to just say, okay, we used an ultimate, but it's not good enough.
Yeah.
We can't really fight this one. If you commit, it can go pear-shaped very quickly. It leaves us tied in kills at 5-5. There's only a 400 gold difference between these two teams as Wicked gonna go aggressive on towards Yellowstar. Nif and Tabs are there as well. Bubble comes in but doesn't land onto Tabs. Meanwhile, Cyanide coming around. There's the cocoon onto Tabs. Orianna is there as well. Tabs at half HP. The shockwave lands onto Nif. Tabs will die at the back. Wicked at full health. And the Acathian surprise will go a long way, but not far enough as it is another 2-0 here for Fnatic.
Wicked still trying to keep them busy. The rest of Alliance are reacting. Froggen and Shook coming around the side here. Fnatic got to be careful. They're all pretty low on hit points, and there's a reset machine ready to go. Shook jumps in. They get a lot of damage on towards Peke. Wicked diving, twisting advance on towards and load these spiderlings there. They're not going to get close enough. Five members of Fnatic will retreat. Alliance, they have an advantage here. They may make onto play Dragon.
But still, Alliance is being a bit overconfident at the moment. They had no wards in the river as the fight started. They had Shook and Froggen in base, and yet they went for the fight. Instantly Fnatic moved down. Four members, they turned it around, pick up some kills. Should be a dragon for Alliance here. But they are giving up some easy kills to Fnatic at the moment.
Oh! Whoa, you didn't want to do that. SOAS able to pick it up with a Glitter Lantern. SOAS having a different game. It's a different beast this match. 3-1-2 with that Lulu. Morellana comes.
Oh, no.
Oh, whoa, Nip! Gonna walk through the Tribus. They're all there. The bubble will land. He'll be able to get away from it, but risky bit of positioning, taking his eye off the ball for a second there, it seemed.
Well, not just for a second. Alliance have done it for the last 2 minutes. They've just been giving up kills left and right. Keep engaging fights, even though they have no idea where the members of Fnatic are. And it cost them. A lot of gold coming back for Fnatic here. They got kills on Reckless, got kills on SOAS. All of a sudden, they're back in the game.
That is the big thing. Kills on Reckless. SOAS waiting around the side. They're going to tower dive. That tower on next to no hit points here. Yellowstar's going to be the key man to engage. Tries to sneak around the side to throw out that bubble. The wave comes down. Niv stops it in his tracks, but Tabs is the target. Wild Growth being used. There's the rockets coming out from Reckless. He takes down one. Gets himself the reset. Niv's the next focus. He goes down. It's now a 5-0-2. Tristana, that is exactly what you need as he just rocket jumps away to safety.
Once again, Fnatic, they get the kills now, they get the towers mid lane, tower went down as well, Xpekka killed it, and they're heading gold. Alliance was so far ahead, Shook was looking so strong, and Fnatic just picks up multiple kills, towers, now they're ahead.
Yeah, and in particular, Reckless, 5-0-2 with his Tristana, Infinity Edge done. His Static Shiv is coming out soon as well. He's 45 CS ahead of Tabs as well. Top lane's ahead, mid lane's ahead. So it was the early kills for Alliance. Fnatic went for more of the safer early game by racking up the farm there. And they are also 3-1 ahead in Zurich, which makes a big, big difference coming in. There's a blue buff for Froggen, who actually will be going into Archangels as his second item, as we've been seeing with the zillion players. On the other side though, for Peke, that Athene's into Sorcerer's Shoes, blasting one. Can you imagine that death cap should be coming into play next for him?
And Fnatic had two kills. They were behind 2,500 gold 5 minutes ago. Now they're sitting on 10 kills. And they're ahead in gold. Didn't get the dragon. Alliance managed to pick it up, but still got a kill for it. Took two towers. 5 minutes and the game is just being completely flipped around, and all of a sudden Fnatic are now pushing down, applying pressure.
This is exactly what they need. So many times we know we were talking about how Shook was getting going, how his stats were working out, but getting kills on your jungle is not always the best deal. Getting a 5-0-2 Tristana, who needs to make it to the late game to get going. Well, he gets a boost, a steroid. He's now going. He is gone. 20 minutes in, he's got himself Static Shift almost complete as well. And Fnatic are in the driving seat with effectively a late game comp.
Yeah, but again, it wasn't even because all the kills went to Shook. It was just Alliance who kept engaging. But they had no vision of Fnatic. They played over aggressive. Now they've been paying the price. But yeah, of course, Fnatic do want to go late game. On the other side, Alliance are looking very strong in the late game too.
Oh, Reckless gonna find Froggen here. He's gonna fancy this fight and he might just kill him off. Ulti will be popped there in the end underneath his own tower though. So Froggen at a point where he can survive, I guess we can call it. We can call his ultimate surviving, I think. Well, that will be down for a little while. Good thing is, you know, when you've got that much cooldown, you can just press R a lot and your ulti's back up in no time. Press W a lot, and then your R's back up in no time, is what I meant.
So, at the moment, Fnatic have themselves the lead. Can they close it out, though? They have yet to really transition it into any inner turrets. All of the outers are down, and it's Alliance that are actually trying to force out some ward control with the dragon over 2 minutes away. It's the bottom turret that they're pushing down. They're trying to clear that wave out. You see Froggen, he's keeping them busy, but look at Fnatic. Five members in this mid lane. They are clear on what goal they want.
Yeah.
And try and shove it on through.
And full credit to Fnatic for playing so well the last few minutes. They've been looking for the fights as well. They got them, starting to run as a team. SOAS joined in, constant fighting in the bottom lane, and Fnatic were just always ahead of Alliance there. They're always one more member, they're always in a better position. So full credit to Fnatic for making their comeback, even though they were only 2,500 gold behind. Still a small comeback.
And you have to wonder if it's going to be Alliance being too confident if you give Fnatic too much room to play with theirs. We just did see Shockwave from Peke used onto Froggen. His ultimate is back up and available now, though. And this bottom turret is going to fall, so that's a bit more gold back for Alliance. Not like Yellow Star and Peke wanted to try and get involved on that one, but they went over the top of a ward and not going to be able to do anything about it. Dragon up in 50 seconds. This is going to be an important one with Fnatic's newfound stamp on the game. Can they hold on and get that one?
Well, the clairvoyance is used. Clairvoyance, quite old. Going a bit old school there. Well, it's technically the same thing. It was used out by Reckless to get vision. Dragon up is 30 seconds away. I think Fnatic are a little off on their timing here. They are holding their position, and well, Alliance are not really too interested right now because they know it's another 15 seconds before it spawns.
Look at all the ping wards Fnatic just placed around this dragon. They definitely want to fight. I mean, Reckless has basically skipped his weak midpoint now. He already has Static Shift and Infinity Edge completed because he got all these kills. So he's looking really good. No death cap yet for Xpeng is going to be the next big deal. But Fnatic, they're looking to fight. They have all the ping wards in place. It's now up to Alliance to move in and engage.
Gotta feel that Nif's gonna be an important part of this one. Whether he can get a good ultimate off of Shook here, going towards Soaz, but the slow's coming in, and Shook can only go so far on this one. He's actually lost more health than damage that he's given out. There's a speed back up. They have managed to force Fnatic away, flash away from the shockwave. Reckless is coming around the side. I don't think he'll stick around though. He's actually gone back into the river, and he's gonna loop around to join the rest of his team.
So two ulties are down here from Fnatic. Alliance staying around here, clearing all the ping wards now. Will they actually start this Baron, Dragon?
This is risky for Alliance. You know, Fnatic, they didn't really lose a lot of hit points. Still no Shockwave though. That's a big deal maker. And again, the wave, which is why Alliance, they're burning down this Dragon. They're going to try and close it out. Shook will smite that one. The question is, will they get out alive? Or will they just try and turn it around? Wicked Pouncer's in there. They jump on towards Soaz. Now Reckless to focus. Nif gets on him, but nobody else is in reading the same wave there. The Aqua Prism doesn't land. Flash comes out. Cyanide gets away. And now Alliance, they're on the retreat. Reckless chasing. Will he jump in? Gets the speed boost from Peke. Oh, risky play. He fancies it. He's waiting to pounce. Now he rocket jumps across. Froggen's the target. Wicked now tanking out all of that damage. Twisted advance to the minions. He should get away safe. Soaz comes across. Flash Glitzerlance! Doesn't quite get the damage down, picks off, and now chases on towards, and Nif is still the only man to go down.
But right here we saw exactly what Fnatic wants to do with their comp. They want Alliance to engage onto them and just instant disengage. There was no Shockwave, no Tidal Wave, and yet they picked up a kill, chased Alliance. As soon as you get the first kill now, you just start chasing. You have Orianna to speed up, you have Lulu to speed yourself up, and of course reset on Tristana. Even Nami is going to speed people up here, so there's so much movement speed for Fnatic here, and once they win the fight, chasing on, force a lot of flashes here from Alliance. Did manage to stop the Dragon. Don't really have any engage, so they can't just run into Alliance. They have to wait for Alliance to actually engage on them.
I think Nif was a little worried there that they could have moved away towards Baron. He will then go up and stick a couple of wards in on the bottom side of it, one up by the Tri-Bush as well, and Fnatic are moving around that area at the moment. Yellow Star will be clearing out first. They'll get Cyanide in as well. Nif not exactly going to be pushing this wave at the top side all that quickly. And we can see Asu is unbreakable as Soaz, who is looking incredibly confident in this game. That flash glitter lance that we saw on the bottom side, he's got a death cap, Morella Nomicon blasting one in there. So it's not like he's not doing a ton of damage. So dangerous times here for Alliance. Farm is down on each side. The kills all stacked up with Reckless. Three for Soaz, two in the mid lane for Peke, who's also got his death cap available now. And his next few minutes going to be a big test for Alliance.
Yeah, small cautionary sign there. Nif was up the top, and it actually drew four members of Fnatic to him, while there was three members of Alliance stood in the middle. So it was never like he was ever going to just stick and push the tower against Soaz. There was never any sign of that. Fnatic reacted quickly though, and now they are the ones being pushing. They're going towards the bottom while Alliance shoving the mid. This is risky play. Fnatic have played this game with Alliance before and came out worse. They are going to go for it again.
Alliance have no minions. They're basically just hitting the tower without any minions, while Fnatic has all the minions in the world here and just pushing down. This is going to be another tower.
Yeah, Alliance have decided to recall it here. And last time that we saw this one happen, Reckless afterwards said, I made the call, and it was the wrong call. This time around, though, they stick in there. Froggen's actually not recalled here with his other teammates. So that will actually mean that he can stick around, get that inner tower. But the inhibitor tower has already gone down. The inhibitor itself is at half HP. I don't think that Fnatic are going to risk it by sticking around any longer. They may now try for a bit of a Baron Dance, though.
Well, at least Wonder Base race picked up even more gold. I mean, things are looking very, very good for Fnatic here. They're making the right decisions. They're suddenly the ones controlling the map, taking towers where there's no response from Alliance, or not a good enough response. Got one taunt, so we can pick up all the farm.
Ooh,
but yeah, they can go Baron now.
Teleport was used. Alliance can go Baron. There is a ward there. Fnatic stick around. Okay. Ooh, that's some big damage on Shook. The Shockwave pulls off. He's taken very low. Has the pounce out there, and that simple play will be enough to force them out now. Baron doing the attacks on Wicked, burning down his hit points. Fnatic down to Peke to do the moves and pull off a play that basically gave Alliance the fear of
now
their lives.
Fnatic is pushing. Look at the mid lane. Rick is already pushing in. Minions are going to come. No ulti for Frog in here. Shook is back in base. This might be another tower for Fnatic.
Can totally afford to tank that up as well. The shield from Lulu, the shield from Orianna, the turret not particularly burning through that even, and that will be an inner turret then. So top lane is an open inhibitor. The rest is just down to those inhibitor turrets, and playing on a knife edge here are Alliance. Fnatic got full vision control of Baron as well. And is this the start of a epic comeback for Fnatic? Because honestly, it would be an epic comeback. Looking at both games that we've already seen, Alliance looked visibly stronger in both, and they weren't very close matches.
Alliance just tried to chase Fnatic back. They've all had to go back to base, but there's so many wards that they can't exactly sneak in and get this Baron bit. They just had to clear out two pinks and sweep one out, which means Fnatic, they will be back. They're all gonna be full hit points, full mana. Ultimates are all off cooldown, so Alliance tried to rush a play. What the hell kind of jump was that, Shook? It was like one of those sail cats that just slip on the top of the slide, not quite make it. Well, everybody's seen the GIF.
Okay. And again, Alliance just trying to get some coverage here, but Soaz went for Void Staff with that last blasting wand, and his damage is just ridiculous at this stage. Top lane actually will be a turret here for Alliance if the minions ever decide that they want to finish that one off. Actually, I don't think they're going to get it, at least for this wave at least. And that means that Alliance will be adding a bit more gold to their total, but it's Fnatic who are holding the dominance over the map. There's a dragon up in 5 seconds, which Fnatic all in position for already. And that should be able to go down quickly before Alliance get to it.
Look how dangerous this is. If Alliance lose this fight, there's a giant wave in the bottom wave and they can just push straight in. Dragon goes down, Shockwave goes off, Fnatic strike. The wave only hits on Nif. That's not the target they wanted. And now Alliance trying to counteract this one. But Fnatic, they have the speed to just back away. And Shook is stopped dead. And well, they hit and run.
Yeah. And this is exactly why Yellowstar can engage with his tidal wave, because every single time Nif is there, puts up the shield like we saw in game 2, and he will just stop it. Still down his bottom lane. Wicked is forced to go down and defend it, and Fnatic once again looking for the fight. Speed up someone, doesn't even matter who, just run towards the lines and try and start a fight here. They're gonna push down. They do have a lot of siege potential because they have so many range, actually 5 range champions. Great siege here, great disengage. I don't feel like they want to go for it just yet.
And just kite all day long, and especially in these areas around the Baron, where that Glitter Lance is probably going to catch a lot of you. A Shockwave will be easier to land, and the knockup from Wild Growth will be all that more effective if they're grouped up in the narrow passages of the jungle. Fnatic, however, looking like they just want to go home and spend a little bit of gold of the last few minutes and come back with then stronger items. If we look at Reckless, Infinity Edge, Blade of the Ruined King, Static Shift, got a bit of magic resist in there as well. The Death Cap for Xpeke there, and another Blasting Wand on top of that one. He'll be getting his blue buff here, and that will mean that he can head back up towards that Baron area, possibly. the possibility of having a fight. Froggen caught a little bit out here in the mid lane. Reckless gonna flash. They managed to pop his ultimate. Reckless has his ulti if he needs to knock him back. He does. He actually knocked him through the wall and maybe away from his team. It's enough to get him the kill though. And that you have to feel is definitely a Baron when you lose the important mid laner with his damage and the utility of his ultimate.
And that's how you pick off a target here. Double speed up for Reckless. He got the E from Nightmare as well, so his auto attacks were going to slow and he just ran forward. Found Froggen here. If they do get this Baron, and just by the fact they are hitting gold, it's so good for them because once they start grouping and seizing at towers, Alliance is forced to engage on them just like Fnatic wants.
Nif caught out, trying to risk it. They needed to try and get some ward coverage, but that's a simple pickup for Fnatic. They're still hanging around. There's still the potential for a steal from Shook, but you gotta feel this Baron is gonna get burnt down so quickly. They're gonna rush straight for the inhibitor turret. They did this the other day. It worked out. They got that inhibitor turret down. That is going to be the Baron. Teleport available to Soaz if he wants to take it. They're going to put a lot of damage in this one, but the simple fact is, Tabs only just completed that Bladed Rune King. He hasn't got anywhere near the damage that Reckless holds.
And this was all about those golden 5 minutes for Fnatic, where they went from having 2 kills, being slightly behind in gold, to just go up to 10 kills, and suddenly they were like 4,000 gold ahead.
Oh, he's dead.
And suddenly they were controlling the game, because as soon as you are ahead with this comp here, and you're the one starting pressing up towers and shoot.
Whoa!
It's gonna die.
Yeah.
It's gonna die. Reckless got a kill even better for Fnatic. But as soon as Fnatic got ahead with this comp here, they didn't have to worry about not being able to engage on Alliance, because now Alliance were forced to engage on them if they want to stop any kind of objective, if they want to stop them from killing towers. And then Fnatic really looked to take this game.
And that point of the game, the mid-game slump, if you call it that, for Tristana was basically just avoided because of all those fights coming in. He's now 7-0-4. He's got 100 CS more than Tabs, and overall just playing very, very confidently. And speaking of confidence, Soaz is in a mood that we've not seen in him at all in this best of five. Quite happy to flash to get that damage down and to chase in there. He's currently 317 himself and has just picked up another needlessly large rod.
Reckless is so confident in himself right now. He's over 4,000 gold ahead of Tabs. He's just roaming around without wards in the enemy jungle. Completely confident because they were all up in that top lane. There was only Wicked nearby, but I think he's going to do a great deal to stop him right now. Reckless is a killing machine. If he gets hold of someone in a straight up 1v1, they will just die.
Yeah, and he didn't even have to build Last Whisper because Wicked had to get some magic resist early on, so there's not enough armor on the side of Alliance to even make the Last Whisper worth it. Therefore, he went for the Blade of the Rune King instead, just to stay even more safe and get also the percent magic damage onto Wicked here, because he knows it's going to be all about him killing Wicked so fast that then the rest of the team can chase on Alliance and get to tap.
And Alliance have got no vision in their own jungle here. That's the problem. That's how they just basically lost that inhibitor. Okay, you might argue that Fnatic would have been able to go in there anyway. But Alliance didn't have those early wards out there to figure out where Fnatic actually were. They were just relying on clearing the wave out of that mid lane. And here is Soaz going to speed himself up. Will he catch Wicked? He does get the slow. Have they got the damage to follow in? No, not yet. But that might force them away from the inhibitor turret.
Trying to catch them out. Shook caught with a cocoon. Not followed up quick enough though, but the minion wave, it's enough. They can just shield a Reckless. He keeps tanking down that turret, putting the damage on towards it. Peke burns away, keeps Nif at guard, and they just keep on poking it down. The rest of Alliance, they're trying to relay race themselves into the base as they get them fountain hit points regenerated. Cyanide takes a burst. This Baron buff, close to a minute left on it, and they're still keeping the pressure on Alliance. That shockwave ball, keep your eye on it, because if it focuses on anyone like Froggen or Tabs, it will fire.
Stud. Waiting for the next wave of those minions to come around, and Reckless again taking the double shields coming through and quite happy to take a tower hit or a little auto attack here and there. But looks like Alliance have actually done enough here to force them back. There's a big wave for Fnatic actually coming down the top lane, of course, will contain super minions as well. Seems like Fnatic fancy themselves a dragon here, get a bit of extra gold.
Now they have actually hit the point where you do want to get Last Whisper for Reckless. That's getting enough armor on Wicked to be annoying, and then Reckless has, at the moment, 3,000 gold. He's just going to get a bit more, then he can go back. I think you're almost getting closer to 4,000 before he decides to back.
I think he's just keep
very, very, very farm AD carry.
It's It's only the second dragon of the game for Fnatic, and that just shows, you know, Alliance had great control early on, but Alliance played into the hands of Fnatic, and as you mentioned, you called it the golden 5 minutes. It really is. And they just turned this game on its head, backing up that AD carry, which they have tried to do throughout. You know, obviously Protect the Vayne kind of worked out last time. It's speed up and launch the Rocket Boy in there, Rocket Girl, I should say, technically, because Merkless is a female, but Peke
Reckless
and Reckless are not.
You got that one the wrong way
Reckless,
around.
Reckless is a female. Well, I'm sure a lot of fangirls out there would argue he's definitely not. He's a popular one, that's for sure, in Gamescom. 14-5 over all the kills, and Fnatic, could they get themselves their first victory here? They have won the last three LCS splits. Nobody in the history of the European LCS has won this. Alliance, they're one step away, but Fnatic, they're not giving up easy.
Again, knocking on the door. There is the engage, though, from Wicked. Has it been enough too much this time? Let's see. Alliance have decided it is time to go. The tidal wave comes through. Bubbles in there as well, but Wicked holding them all away. Shook got the ultimate from Froggen. They didn't lose too much from that one here, Alliance.
No, and you just see how far behind Alliance actually is. I mean, yeah. They want to go for the engage. Easy disengage from Fnatic. Reckless is back to full HP already. Ulti was used by Froggen. This tower is going to go down as soon as Nip decides to die.
Oh, Nip is going to die. Rectus gets himself another 8-0-4. The MVP of the season showing exactly how it's done as he just keeps on tanking it down. Look at the size of that shield he has on him. The double shield comes out. That's going to be the second inhib of the game going down. Super Minions actually starting to put some work on towards the Nexus turrets as well. But Fnatic, they're just going to back away. Baron's up in a minute. They can go back and spend that massive chunk of gold they've got.
And that was the problem for me in last game. The Unbreakable was unbreakable. They couldn't get through, but this time they actually said, you know what, doesn't matter, just keep focusing him. He gets knocked around with everything else and able to finish him off. And the turret leaves an 8-0-4 Reckless, who probably, well, he's going to have six items next time that he does decide to go home. Obviously, we'll change that QSS into a scimitar, and who knows, maybe even sell off those boots, come back in with a couple of elixirs to work with as well. For Soaz, he's now added in the Zhonyas, which is only going to make him more confident. We've already seen him flashing in to get the knockup from Wild Growth, and to get the slows going down. Here they come from the side once again.
Gonna jump on towards him. Wicked's gonna try and react. He got onto Reckless. Reckless forced out of the fight. Now Alliance with Reckless gone. Can they try and create something here? They got a good bunch of damage onto Reckless, but they couldn't follow through. The Resurrect comes through. Froggen focuses on Cyanide. He repels away. There's no Wraith to drop to, so they will get him down. Or will they? The big shield comes out. The Wild Growth comes out. And Wicked now, the tankiest member, is just getting shredded down. Cyanide does go down to Froggen, but Reckless, he's back. He's got the hit points, and he is looking for revenge onto Alliance. They force them away. It's a 2-for-2, but it's Fnatic pushing down the mid lane with the Super Minions.
Pushing down here. There's no ulti for Yellowstar or Source, and Reckless is not done yet.
Oh, Shug actually got the bomb on him there, so they had to get away from him. Yellowstar down pretty low. There's Reckless getting another couple of hits off. Soaz is fairly low, but there is Reckless. Can he get one? The ulti went out to Shug, which means Froggen dies. Reckless is going to have
nice
the shield.
Bubble.
The bubble onto him, and that's a double kill for Reckless. Only if left alive, they can finish right here.
Reckless, like a machine gun, 10-0-6, follows on through and guns down every minion in sight, whether it be a champion or a little minion insane. He's going to get in there. Fnatic, it's going to be 2-1, ladies and gentlemen. We will get ourselves a game four. Fnatic are not done yet. They are holding strong, and it was a great turnaround. Dominant performance, and Alliance, it's not going to be that easy.
Such a well-deserved win here, and such an important confidence booster as well. I said it earlier about Soaz in particular, a man who doesn't play well when he's not feeling good, when the pressure, you know, is on him and he's not performing. That's the scenario where you can really bully Soaz around the games. But something was said between game two and three, because he came into this one, got his hands yeah. on Lulu, played like a different beast compared to the first games.
Well, with Aaron Ayer as a coach, you know something was said, that's for sure. Whether it was helpful or not, that's another matter. But at the moment, it seemed to work out. Pick and Ban, you know, we questioned some of that. We questioned, you know, Lulu comes out for Soaz, but that protect, the ball, the defensive, the shields, that was massive. And Reckless was free to do what he wanted.
It really ended up working out well for Fnatic because, again, the 5 minutes. They were actually behind in the start. Two Alliance, they had strong lanes, but Shook was just killing people left and right. They were behind the goal, they lost the first dragon again. But then they had those 5 minutes where Reckless picked up 5 kills. And they just constantly outnumbered Alliance, they outsmarted them, won every single fight, got so far ahead in goal that suddenly now Alliance had to actually engage onto Fnatic now to try to defend objectives, and it just didn't work because that's where the comp was so good, because you could just kite. You didn't have any engage yourself, but you could always kite. And because your AD carry gets 5 kills before 20 minutes, there's no weak mid game, that's gone. Like, you just go straight late game now and start scaling even more, and the game just completely fell out of the hands of Alliance. After those 5 minutes, they were so far behind, they couldn't do anything. Everyone else from Fnatic just stepped up and won the game.
What do we think to pick some bans then? There are obviously a few, smaller changes in this one. Orianna, of course, did come through, got into the hands of XPK, was able to follow up nicely. A Zillion pick for Froggen, which for me, despite his early pressure, didn't give Alliance the power that you'd maybe expect them to have in the mid lane.
So it's very hard to judge the combo for Alliance because they fell so far behind. Not necessarily it wasn't the mistake of the comp, it was more the fact the fights they chose were very wrong and were taken at the wrong time. So you can't really question the comp and say, yeah, it didn't work out, the comp was bad, because if they had kept the goal lead, we might have stood there and said, okay, 3-0, last comp was great, and that would have been it. So we can't really question the comp here. It actually looked good on paper, it just didn't work out for them.
Well, it's blue side next for Fnatic. Let's go over towards our analyst desk to see how they figured out that match.
Thank you very much, D-Man. Yeah. Well, Fnatic is not out of this one yet. They pull it back in with not the craziest picks or the smartest picking ban, but just comfort picks coming in.
I'm so glad you said that, because I completely agree. I felt like games 1 and 2, while Fnatic, I don't want to say they were uncomfortable, they were a little bit of uncharacteristic champions. So is in particular. He's very vocal. He's not a big fan of tanky tops. You know, he's not a big fan of those frontline bruiser type champions, tanks rather. Going back to Lulu, despite it not being super relevant in the meta, he's super comfortable. He's got so much experience on that champion. Orianna for Peke, I mean, when does he not deliver on that champion? And finally, we see the Tristana coming out as well, as opposed to that Vayne. Could have happened game one. Reckless gets it game 3, manages to pick up the win.
See, I don't think the picks matter as much as what you do with them, and I like that Fnatic had a plan, and they used Sovas's Lulu really well in terms of speed-ups. This is something I mentioned in game one, that I would like Zillion to do more in that game, just speed somebody up and then they go for the engage. How many times did we see Reckles just storm forward, jump in, and catch people out of position? Yeah, Froggen often had his ulti, but still had to blow it every time, and I really like the way Sovas took control of this game, both with his teleports, with the momentum, with speeding people up, flashing in. He showed that he mastered a champion, because he cancelled so many dashes. Even Braum mid-air, he would just knock up with his ultimate. And Sovas is a player, like, if you look at the player cam, you can see how a game is going with some players. And Sovas is definitely one of them. He was all grumpy and moody, and then it starts going well, and he's sitting there smiling, and he just plays so much better game.
Yeah, so he did get going on that Lulu, and a lot came from. They got the standard lanes this time, and they had the superior matchups that went very well for them.
Yeah, I really liked that they actually had the normal laning phase. However, it's still the same thing though. The vision control in bottom is not enough. Alliance was taking control of this game again. Shook is impeccable, goes up top, gets the gank off. Shook is basically playing in the enemy jungle all the time, contesting buffs at one point, like goes from this buff to the other one. But Fnatic held on, and then at one point they turned a switch, and from playing in the lead, it was shown that Fnatic can actually still play this game.
Yeah, I actually felt in this game, Fnatic made far less mistakes than in games 1 and 2. You know, those individual misplays and missteps. And I actually felt Alliance may have been a tad over-aggressive. They may have been a little too hungry. They had two fairly one-sided wins in the previous matches, so it could be a testament from that. But I do think less mistakes from Fnatic allow them to survive longer, allow them to come away less burned, if that makes sense, than they have in the previous matches.
You do mention overconfidence, and we're actually going to take a look at a replay, because Defisher was talking about those golden 5 minutes for Fnatic that got things going, and Krepo, you wanted to highlight this one.
Yeah, basically what's going to happen here is Nifk is going to go for a play if we roll the clip right away. He's going to catch Jelsar, that's good, but there's a little miscommunication. Nifk wants to go forward, Tabs wants to just poke him over the wall, gets busted shut out, and basically Nifk is too far out right now, forces Tabs to flash in, and then Soas just instigates the teleport right here, and this is what Fnatic needs. Like, if they can't bring Rekkles to the fights, they might as well bring the fights to Rekkles, and that's the way they're gonna win these games. And again, they're fighting around bottom and around Dragon, and that will give them an advantage and vision control, and I really like that Fnatic's actually doing this more, because back in the day, when the meta game, when you had aggressive top laners, you could trade a Dragon for a top tower and get some control in the top lane. But with all these like tanky utility top laners, I feel it's a lot better to invest all your attention and wards in the bottom side of the map around Dragon, around those objectives. And this time Fnatic did that eventually, but it still required a mistake from Alliance to actually get in that position.
Yeah, and those next few minutes, every time something happened, Rekkles was involved as a central focal point for Fnatic. Again, stark contrast from game one and two. He was split pushing on Vayne, trying to, or farming the side lanes on Vayne, trying to get to a relevant power point. On Lucian, he was unable to be the central focal point because by time they were starting to group, Alliance were too far ahead. So it was nice to see that when the drama and the action was happening, he was involved, he was picking up those last hits or the kill secures, and he managed to get powerful enough. Deficio said it best. When you go 5-0 before 20 minutes, you don't have a weak mid game because you're already in the late game.
Yeah, and by proxy, it was always Soaz coming down, because every time Rekkles got a pick or something happened, it was Soaz just speeding up either himself or Rekkles at the bottom side of the map. So Soaz really transitioned like that lead that he had in the top lane into a good teleport into bottom, and I really liked what they were doing, like the way they were playing their comp. You can argue whether you think the comp is better on one side or the other, but at least Fnatic knew what their comp had to do, and they pulled it out.
So let me throw this over to you guys. This time, Fnatic had those golden 5 minutes, which allowed them to build up a very big lead, which maybe allowed them to make those little mistakes in the fights and in the communication they had before, but we couldn't notice it because they were that far ahead.
I would say that's a fair point. I mean, whenever you do build up a lead, whenever you do have an advantage, you can afford to have small mistakes and get away with them because of the advantage. However, I don't think the advantage was big enough for them to really do that. This time around, they just didn't make mistakes. Alliance, in previous games where they've been behind, they fell behind to SK multiple times. They played passive, they played backwards, waited for the mistake, and then punished. I actually feel like once Fnatic got that lead, they played more aggressively and they did move around that map, more so than what SK did in the semifinals.
At the same time though, Fnatic, they fell behind early again. Their rotations were good once they were 4,000 or 5,000 gold ahead. Yeah. So they had enough pressure on Alliance to force them around the map. But before that, I still think Alliance is a smarter team and the better team. So next game, it's going to require an instance like we had this game where Fnatic takes a huge lead early in the game, because otherwise I think Alliance is going to control the pace again. And this time, they're not going to overreach.
Just also to be fair, I just want to finish that point. excuse me. The laners were much stronger for Fnatic. Despite the fact they did fall behind and Alliance were a little more powerful, head-to-head lanes, stronger lane champions for Fnatic, and they get to a point where they can punish mistakes.
So in order to get to a game five here, so another Fnatic win, strong laners and standard lanes is the key, but they have to step up in those standard lanes.
Yeah, and please.
Please.
Place wards around Dragon. Please,
wards
Fnatic.
Win games.
Yes, they do, and they save lives. We're going to step away for just a minute, but when we come back, Fnatic has forced a game four in the finals as we get closer to crowning a champion. Stay tuned.
That's going to be Rekkles getting himself one kill. Gets the reset. Taps goes down. There's the rockets coming out from Rekkles. He takes down one. Gets himself the reset. Nips the next focus. He goes down. And Wicked now, the tankiest member, is just getting shredded down. Cyanide does go down to Frogger, but Rekkles, he's back.